Good morning, Bay Street. Stephen Whiteside here with your daily market outlook for Tuesday, July 3rd, 2012. It's coming up to 8:30 on the East Coast, and stock index futures are slightly above fair value, as are commodities. So we are looking for a little buying at the open on Tuesday morning. Now, today's a shortened workday in the U.S. ahead of the July 4th holiday weekend, so not expecting a lot of volatility today as the U.S. markets close at 1 o'clock. Now, tomorrow, our offices will be closed. No videos tomorrow morning, but we will do charts, Canadian charts, tomorrow night. Now, over the weekend, we added a new indicator to the bottom of some of the 60-minute and daily charts called the Dominant Trend Indicator. It's a quick reference tool, and so as you're scanning through charts, you can keep track of when the major trend changed. The dominant trend for the Venture Exchange changed back in early March. If we go to a weekly chart, we can see that's about the time that the weekly charts changed trend. So of course, when you're looking at a weekly chart, the dominant trend for a weekly chart comes from the monthly chart. When you're looking at a daily chart, the dominant trend comes from the weekly chart. And when you're looking at a 60-minute chart, the dominant trend comes from the daily chart. And so when you're looking at a dominant trend, if the market is going the opposite direction, then of course that would be a counter trend. And so right now, because the dominant trend is in a decline, any rally here is called a counter trend rally. And that's why people tend to sell those counter trend rallies as they come up to resistance, like moving averages or price targets or our flypaper channel. Now, using this as a reference tool, each one of our charts, none of them are really synced up to give you the same number of bars on each chart, and it's hard to match some of them up even if we wanted to. On this chart, we leave some room for the projections over here, and so that is going to be hard to line up with other charts that go right to the right hand side. But you can see where the dominant trend indicator changes at the bottom, left being bullish, red being bearish. If we move to the right side chart, you can see that the dominant trend indicator, the change, moved a little to the left, and that's because we actually show more bars on the screen, so you can get a closer look at the channels and where we are relative to the channels. And over here, of course, we still leave some room for the values of the upper and lower channel line. As we continue through the charts, we move back a bit to the right as we show more bars on the screen for the smart money chart. We show even more bars on the screen for the price target chart. And as we move to the midterm chart, it actually lines up pretty well with the oscillator at the bottom here. Remember, the midterm, we're looking at longer term price moves as opposed to the right side chart. So this is more conservative money. This is a more conservative view of this particular symbol. And so you can see that the change to the downside and the change to the upside here was pretty similar to the waterline. When the oscillator moves above and below the waterline, that's pretty close. It's this indicator is independent of this particular analysis, and it's independent of the weekly analysis, just designed to give you an overall view of the long-term dominant trend. Next up, when we look at the realistic expectation model, this particular chart has the three major moving averages that people follow, the 50, the 100, and the 200-day moving average, and the dominant trend is usually when we're below all of those moving averages. You can see we took a run up to try to break out above the 200-day moving average and couldn't do it. During that time frame when we were running up, the dominant trend changed from negative to positive, and then we started to break down back down below all the moving averages, and the dominant trend, of course, came back down to negative. Now, it's not on the flypaper chart. We don't really need it because the dominant trend, you can tell what's going on here. If we're above the flypaper channel, the dominant trend is positive. If we're below it, it's negative. At the same time, to produce the flypaper channel, it actually takes a lot of CPU power, and then we've added these other indicators, and so we've really run out of CPU room to actually add another indicator to this chart, so it won't be on the flypaper channel chart. So that's it, dominant trend indicator. It's a little reference tool at the bottom of the screen to help you when you're scanning between charts to let you give you a reference point of when the dominant trend has changed in the past. Next up, let's take a look at weekly charts, and no major changes last week. We still have crude oil in a major downtrend. It did not close above the previous week's high. There's a chance we might do that this week. But obviously, with crude oil in a major down move, it's hard to see a lot of money come back into energy stocks, except for natural gas, which is doing okay right now. You can see in the scheme of things, the up move that we've seen in natural gas over the past few weeks really doesn't erase the major decline, but it is still bullish, and we're still long natural gas. No major changes for the metals, for copper, for gold, for silver. They're all in weekly declines, and of course, that's not helpful for the overall Canadian stock market. The TSX, energy, financial services, still all on weekly sell signals. Gold stocks, which tried to break out over the past couple of weeks, have declined. They're not back below the channel line, or they have not closed back below the channel line, but they have traded through the lower channel line, so not positive for gold stocks. And our last weekly chart, the Venture Exchange, still making new lows as of last week. Now, last Friday, we had a huge move up in the markets, and I posted, sent an email out because I couldn't do a video last Friday morning. And from the time I sent the email to the time the market opened, the futures had actually doubled. And so it, of course, was the catalyst was news, positive news out of Europe. Of course, that was fueled by short covering. It was fueled by end of quarter, end of month window dressing. It was also fueled by the fact that any time that you're going into a U.S. holiday, the markets are historically move higher. And so you put all those things together and the market had a great up move and generated a lot of daily buy signals. But we're not seeing a lot of follow through. And there's some things that I'm still watching that have not come to pass. And that's a bit of a concern, but they are what they are. We have a daily buy signal for the TSX. We have a daily buy signal for the S&P 500, of course. And yesterday we moved a little higher of the previous high. Have not done so yet for the NASDAQ 100. Now, bonds were actually up yesterday. And we want bonds to come down. We want money to flow out of bonds to fuel a rally in stocks. That hasn't happened. We want the US dollar to come down. It was actually up yesterday. We want the euro to go up. It was actually down yesterday. Canadian dollar, nothing going on there yesterday. But, you know, if the rally is going to continue, we need money to flow out of bonds. We need money to come out of the US dollar. And that hasn't happened so far. Yesterday, global markets were higher, including in the U.S., and so the global Dow continued to move higher on Monday. Taking a look at commodities, no major changes on Monday. Inside day for crude oil, it's up in the pre-market this morning. Gasoline moved lower yesterday, so we might actually get a sell signal on Tuesday if we see it follow through to the downside. No change for heating oil, no change for natural gas, no change for copper inside day yesterday. No change for gold, no change for silver. Both of those are up in the pre-market on Tuesday. Next up, let's take a look at the daily index charts. And we're now back on a buy signal for the TSX. And so that would mean all the ETFs that follow the TSX. That's a similar situation for energy stocks and the ETFs that follow energy stocks. For financial services, not for gold. Gold is still on a sell signal, so no change there. And not for the Venture Exchange, no change there. Our Research in Motion, which was down sharply on Friday, I was down a little lower yesterday, but recovered and actually closed higher on the day in the U.S. Taking a look at some of the recent winners, Cameco has been doing very well the last couple of weeks, coming up to previous resistance. Hopefully, you can get up and over that. Looking at a long-term chart of Cameco, you can see the big open gap caused by the tsunami in Japan. That, of course, will be a major wall of resistance to get up and over. The fertilizer stock still doing well. Agrium and Potash both continuing to hold their uptrend. Last up this morning, a quick look at some 60-minute charts. The VIX for the TSX is below the flypaper channel. That's bullish for the Canadian stock market. On Friday, it was kind of an odd move. You can see that we popped higher at the open and then treaded water for the rest of the day for the TSX, for energy stocks, for the financial services, and for gold stocks. And so that's not very, that's not very enticing, the fact that we popped at the open and then treaded water the rest of the day. So we didn't see new buyers come in. We didn't see new sellers come in after the market opened. And that's doesn't add a lot of confidence to the move. Looking at the Venture Exchange, still below the flypaper channel, no change there. So what are we looking for on Tuesday? An hourly close below 11,486 would give us a sell signal for the TSX. 231.67 for energy stocks, 171.95 for the financial services, And while gold stocks are still below the flypaper channel, you know, if they get up and over a flypaper channel, that's when we start talking about daily buy signals. We're on an intraday buy signal, and that would stay in place on Tuesday as long as we don't start closing below 299.95. Okay, that's all for Tuesday morning, and that's all for me till Thursday. Have a great day, and if you're listening to us in the U.S., have a great 4th of July, and otherwise we'll talk to you again on Thursday morning.